All right, ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the first ever installment of Knights of the Apocalypse, the channel that we show you how to make some sick weapons and armor so you can get medieval into zombies. Today's build, we're going to be building Bechdel, possibly the best chainmail you can make. It consists of plates with maille holding them together. This was used in the 16th century in Eastern Europe and possibly the Middle East. So, let's get to it.
Okay, for this build, we are going to need a hammer, preferably a metalworking one. Ball peen is good. You probably also use pretty much any hammer that has just a very slightly dished face to it. We're going to need a punch, like a nail set, for marking where our holes are going to be. We're going to need 18-gauge tin snips. They do make 16-gauge ones, but these will actually go through 16-gauge. You just got to give it a little effort. You'll need a Sharpie to mark up your metal. You'll need clippers for cutting chainmail rings. And you also need two pair of needle-nose pliers for shaping the maille. You'll need a 7/64 inch drill bit. You may need an angle grinder with a flap disc, preferably a high grit one. 80/120 is best. Some 16, preferably 14 gauge wire, and some 18 gauge sheet steel. You can use 16 gauge, but that should be a little on the heavy side. You don't want to use 20. I know a lot of people make armor out of 20 gauge and below, but that's really too thin and it won't really protect you. But the cool part about this build is that since the plates are so small, you can use scrap metal. Oh, you'll need a vise too. I kind of forgot to mention that. Preferably one with an anvil on the back. But if you don't have one, you can squish it together and try to use this top part as an anvil. Alright, so what we're really trying to make is this. These are these scales. This one's a little on the large side. It's about 1 3/4 by 2 inches, and it's got 4 holes drilled on the inside. What you'll probably want to do is make something more along the lines of, say, this. This is much smaller. This is about that compared to it. So it's 2 inches by about, looks like, maybe 3/4 wide. Historical examples usually show smaller plates like this. So this is what we're gonna make. Rather than measure these little plates out 8 million times, I've just made a little paper template. Paper can be a little hard to trace. So another good option is to just measure out one of these, make it, and then use that as your template. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to put it on the metal like so. Take a Sharpie. Just trace out your piece. Although note, the one you trace will be bigger than the original. So you want to make your pattern just slightly smaller. The original one. And I'm also going to put a little mark in each of these holes. Okay, so I went through, compared the holes, make sure they all lined up and everything. And now I'm going to take my 18 gauge tin snips. I'm going to cut out my piece. This may take a little bit of effort, but it shouldn't be too much. Sorry, I didn't come handed. Here's the first cut. There's the second. Now we have our piece. I'm also going to go through and nip these corners off to make certain there's nothing that's going to poke me while I'm wearing it. Because we want to keep this as safe as possible. Also, it's important to note that in the pieces that are at the top and the pieces that are at the bottom of the rows, you're going to want to put 4 holes on one side. So 2 pieces for every row you do should have 4 holes at the top and the bottom so you can connect it to the rest of the maille. Here, I'll show you what I'm talking about. See, like that, there's rows and the bottom ones
have four holes so you can connect it to the rest of the mail. I would make a tutorial on how to make chainmail, but honestly, it'd be white noise. There are about 8 million, gajillion, trillion tutorials on how to make chainmail, so you can just go look up your own or whatever. Just Google how to make chainmail, and I'm sure a million people have already done a much better job than I could ever do anyway. This is a tutorial on how to make the scales. It's best when you're holding these things to hold them with a pair of pliers. That way when you put it, and if the drill bit catches and this goes spinning, this cuts the pliers, not you. I wouldn't recommend gloves because that might get caught in the shoe. It's also really important to wear eye protection and ear protection. If you'll notice, there's a burr left behind on each of these. Now the way you combat this, again, holding this with a pair of pliers, take a power drill, a very large drill bit like this, and just slightly kiss each hole. And you'll notice it'll take that burr right off. So do that to all four holes to make sure they're safe. Okay, I didn't show you that whole process, but basically all I did was clean up the device and put a bevel on each of the edges to make sure it's safe. You might want to go to the sides too, just a little bit, but this way it won't catch on the clothing. You can skip that step, but then just don't let it touch your skin and whatever clothing you're wearing underneath it. Make sure you don't care about it. Now, if you notice, it may have warped a little bit during the process of cutting it. Now, you can correct this end edge strength by hammering. Now, either most people don't have an anvil like I do, but you can also use, like I said, the anvil of ice for clamping the top. Or if you get your hands on a piece of railroad track like this, this makes a great anvil. So what we're going to do is we're going to hammer the entire inside of this surface, trying to make it overlap as much as humanly possible. I will show you that on the railroad track. Now if you notice, it's difficult to see here, but all my hammer strokes overlap. And if you can tell on the other side because the surface of the metal will pick up what's ever on here. So you can keep track of how you're doing. You want to do this to the entire inside of the piece. There we go. That's called hammer hardening. It gives it a little bit of shape, it curves it a little bit, but it also makes it much stronger. Now this is a step that you can skip too, because it is kind of time consuming, but it does add enough strength that it's definitely worth doing it. Alright, now I have a few of these made. I think I have about 6. Obviously you're going to need more than that. But this is just to show you how, so I'm going to stop for now, because I already have a shirt effector. Now, I already have these rings made, but like I said, there are 8 gajillion tutorials on how to make chainmail, so I'm not going to bother. Just look up a tutorial. There's a million of them. There's no point in me making another one. I will give you the ring specifications though. These should be about a quarter inch. These are 16 gauge. If I were you, I would do 14 gauge in the front and 16 gauge in the back. That way it's lighter or you have the protection where you really need it. A lot of people say chainmail is useless, but 14 gauge butting, especially if it's stainless steel, is actually pretty good. So, first things first, we have our pliers, and we have some open rings. Here's what you want to do. Take a plate and put it over top of the other one. It doesn't really matter if they're going like this
or if you're going like this. Now, if you'll notice, these holes should overlap each other. So, get two plates with the holes overlapping. So, and weave a ring through each end, like that. Then close it up. Alright, so I cut out the part of me just weaving rings together, because you'd already seen what I was doing and that would be boring. So next what you want to do is make sure they're all kind of facing the same way. I'm orientating this the way you would look at it, not me. So you want the rings to be kind of facing you, tilted backwards like this, or like that, as opposed to this. So you want the rings to be facing like that. Next step is to take one ring, like so, and weave it through four of these rings. So you want to go in through the first ring, in through the second, then come around behind, then in through the second ring, and in through the first, like so. Take it. All is said and done, you should have a ring that looks just like that. So we're going to do it again. Take a ring, open it up, and do the same thing. I'll see if I can get my hands out of the way this time. In through the first ring, in through the second, and then on the opposite row, we go in through the back ring, and up through the first, like that. So when you're finished, this ring here should be over top of that ring. That's what you want. Alright, so now we have our first little section of victim. I had a problem when I encountered that the rings would get tighter and tighter, so what I ended up doing was I had to like add in an extra ring and kind of go against the weave every once in a while, just to give it a little more room to move. You can do these in different sizes, different shapes, although the rule of thumb is the more plates you have, the smaller plates you have, the more the armor will flex. That's basically all you're doing, is just making rows of plates and putting them together. So that is your tutorial on how to make Bector. I will put on my shirt, give you a few more pointers, and then we'll close up this.
Okay, so here's my shirt, Bector, and here's some important tips and tricks. First things first, you can't actually make an entire vest of Bector and just pull it on. It has to be open, either one side or both. Now mine's kind of fancy, I've got buckles and straps here. If you want, you can just drill a hole in plates on either side and then tie it together with paracord or shoelace, or rawhide leather would be best, although you'll have to have somebody else tie it for you. So like I said, one side, mine's only one side and solid on the other. It's probably easy to put on if you do both, though. Another thing is that you only want the plates to come to your natural waistline, which is the squishy part between your ribs and your hips. If you have it any further, you won't be able to bend over. So make sure these plates stop at the natural waistline and come bend down. If that is nothing more, it's just typical chainmail. Also, if you are going to have stuff come down, it's best to wear it with a pretty tightly cinched belt, because that will distribute some of the weight off of your shoulders on your hips, which make life much better. I've also added sleeves, but again, these plates really aren't all that flexible. They only flex a little bit, so my sleeves have a lot of chainmail. I also have chainmail going over the shoulders. It would be kind of uncomfortable to have plates. Another thing you can do is to make it 16 gauge in the back and put less plate to make it lighter, and 14 gauge in the front to make it stronger. That way you've got protection right where you need it. And on the other side, you compromise a little bit of protection, but you've got less weight. So that said, I want to know what you think. Do you have any cool designs or what you want to make out of Bector? I want to know if you're going to experiment with different shapes, different size plates, different parts of the body too, maybe not just a vest, maybe vector gauntlets or some kind of a helmet. I want to see what you do with it. So I will put my email right here, or somewhere on the screen. And that is all for this video. That said, come back, and if it's popular enough, we will have some more stuff.